This is Two Bees Determined versus Bee Genius Escape. It is from an EU tournament. The Zodiac Cup. And the Zodiac Cup is a community based around making tournaments that has been running since Warcraft 3. It's been going a long time. It's an EU tournament this time. They do different regions. But this is a particularly interesting Warhead Junction. And one of the questions I get the most is, how do you play Warhead Junction? Everything we assume is that you do a bunch of global heroes, but what actually has the highest win rate are standard heroes that you see on every single map. So what gives, and should I be using global heroes? And the real question, the answer to that is, I don't know. That's why I'm here. That's why I'm here investigating this replay from the Zodiac Cup, the EU edition of it, with 2Bees Determined versus Bee Genius Escape. And I'm here on the side of 2Bees. And 2Bees is interesting here because they are, spoiler alert, I know, but they're going to be the winner here. But that's what's fascinating, because the enemy team's got Falstad, the enemy team's got Dahaka. These guys, 2Bees, decided to go medic. Maybe we'll see a stage dive. And we have a Medivh, maybe. Is that enough? But a Tychus and a Kerrigan, these aren't very mobile. But on the enemy side, too, we have a Hammer. So our immediate thought would be, you know, thinking about how to draft for Warhead Junction would be to get a bunch of globals, fly around, group up real quick, fly around to another area, get that bright wing under your belt or something like that. But that doesn't seem to be the case, and certainly we're repeatedly seeing those same facts in our win rates on Hotslogs. So what gives, and what are these guys doing here that makes them so darn fancy? So that's what we're gonna figure out here. And just judging at the middle, we have Falstad going down. This would be the side of Bee Genius here. They're gonna put three into the bottom. Dahaka's gonna go top, definitely the most isolated lane. I mean, top is usually where you put that Bright Wing or anything else along those lines, so it makes sense he's making his way up there. Kerrigan, Medivh are gonna buddy around a little bit. ETC's kind of making his way down to the bottom, but no one's really seen anybody yet. So we'll see what happens. A little bit of a poke blind. Grenade goes out from the medic, pushing, disengaging the hammer from the range. They're gonna do a little boosted dance in the bush there. I like this combo, though. I mean, Medivh able to put out anti-burst shields, and Kerrigan able to regenerate herself. Looks like Medivh and Kerrigan are actually going to make their way up to the top, and Falstad's going to visit while Johanna covers the middle lane. Down in the bottom, it's still this sort of three-man push going on, with ETC kind of dancing between the two. Unstable here on the Malfurion with the tank. The tank's not going to use a lot of magic. Can't really spam their spells no matter how hard they try. I mean, siege mode is 100% free. You got your little mines, sure, get out more mines, but Innervate isn't the place to be right now. But our globals are in the top, ready to react at a great distance. Medivh should be able to get out of there, and Kerrigan's now left alone in the middle. So interesting where these players are deciding to put their weight. Of course, with ETC right here, great route actually to intercept him. They're going to continue to push that out here. Looks like Kerrigan's going to grab the site. And we need to keep in mind our timers here. And timers are about 2:45. And then it could be up to 4 minutes to the next one.
Warhead deployment beginning. Prepare for collection.
And that would be 2:45 here on the replay timer. 2 minutes flat at the top of the screen there. So Medivh's gonna hover around, maybe get a little bit of poking out. Medic's gonna do the channeling, which they should. Support should channel. If the support isn't needed to heal stuff, they're the only person without a job at the moment. Medivh's going on a wild ride, but his portals and his shields are serving him well. Is he gonna try to poke this out? All right. This is from after last Wednesday's patch where they changed the numbers. So we no longer have to worry about 14 minute as much, but also the center of the nuke, that little tiny circle, is going to be doing half as much damage. The percentages can always be a little weird sometimes, so I won't go and make that claim. But it went from 100% bonus damage to 50% bonus damage, and I just want to see where Medic decides to drop it. Uh-oh. Uh-oh, looks like we're getting some replay oddities already showing up. Some black holes in the ground. Medic's gonna close in and just drop it. Okay, so gonna make sure it gets the wall and at least one turret in the maximized area. That actually did phenomenal work, took out the entire wall. And now they're gonna rotate on up. And Falstad's holding onto his nuke right now. Deciding to actually use it quite a bit different. Gonna see if he can touch the fort a little bit. Equally as effective, I guess there was some damage done to this wall beforehand. But Eve gets a little locked in the top for now. They do end up getting a hold of Malfurion in the middle during that. So maybe just some superior rotations going on. Here comes ETC. He's going to cover the bottom for a bit. He'll need help, though, against Hammer. Or he'll just lose a bunch of health and be frustrating and probably end up pushing the Hammer back anyway. And since those guys were in the top, they haven't had a need to move, so they've been rather isolated for a bit. One could say that they're underusing their traits, their flights, their digs onto Haka. I mean, Medivh's going to be able to power this out for quite a bit. Actually, what build is Medivh doing to defend this lane? So far, just Unstable Portal and Bird's Eye View. We also have a block party for ETC, which I'm seeing a lot of, but there are plenty of auto attacks with a hammer on the enemy side. So that makes sense. And bigger they are for Tychus, actually. If we look at the enemy team, there is double tank, so you certainly could power up a nice long in the rhythm. But decide to go with the bigger they are, probably because the various lanes, not always up against tanks in such a wide map. Medic's there to take care of herself for now, doing that automated block. That makes sense. Low mobility hero, high mobility dudes over here. We got a little bit of innervate and some range. And actually, wingman for the Falstad. So we'll see how that works for him in the late game. And then one of my favorite level 1 Dahaka talent, Primal Aggression, which is going to increase his damage against minions and mercenaries and allow him to farm the top. And with the Johanna, you don't really have to be main tank there. I guess they're just defending their lanes. We have quite a while still before that very next nuclear dish out. Nuclear. Dahaka shows up just in time to body block the tank on their way out a little bit. Now we've got three again in the bottom. Falstad still in the top, Medivh up there. So Medivh is actually very stationary. I expected him to be hovering between lanes for some sort of sweet scouting business. Maybe he's been locked up here by the Falstad and Dahaka aggression, or maybe this was actually a plan, and they were going to see if Medivh could be a good laner, actually. And with these arcane shots he's putting out, it does seem like he has some decent lane clear on him. Here goes our first big bird transformation. He's going to make his way across the map. So it looks like it was at the 3 minutes, so they picked him up pretty quick. This one is deploying around the 5 minute mark. Medivh's gonna go into the top once again versus the Falstad. And Medic goes on the back, which she should, channeling and all that. Kerrigan runs into the front here, gonna do some disruption, try to run away, get caught up in the roots, but here comes ETC. They've actually put Dahaka in the top as well, once again. Interesting to see that they embrace this global combo. They're both sitting on nukes now. And they do end up getting Medivh. No need to nuke this, though. So they're just gonna sit on them for a bit. Here comes Hammer up as well. Counter pressure in the middle. You're already losing top. don't bother defending anything. Let's soak out the bottom. Everything's focused on 10 at the moment. Kerrigan's trying to poke forward a little bit. We got... looks like still two nukes on each side. Sadly, our bottom counter is broken for the replay. Two nukes in here. They're going to go ahead and sneak a boss while they're up there. Getting Hammer and Malfurion in on it. And here comes Johanna herself. And maybe she's just going to take a little sight tower, see if she can drag them away. Players should suspect that something's going on, so they're going to take their bruiser camp here. Probably so they don't end up with the old bruiser stolen after the boss goes by. Problem. And they're still sitting on two nukes of their own. Will they use them on the boss? I assume the enemy Dahaka and Falstad are going to take the opportunity to nuke the front door, or at least the fight area, as the boss comes in. But who knows? They could hold on to it. They could go global. They could go fly to the bottom lane and take out that fort down there. Medivh getting a little caught behind, but everything's going to be okay. There's a nuke. Ooh, cool use of the ley lines there to interrupt the nuke as they deep engage here. Kerrigan's a little stuck in the back, actually, gets silenced. But they are actually able to push him back. They get rid of Malfurion. They have to bail. Laser goes down, burning the boss. And our little number catcher, again, is wrong here. But oh, here goes Medic. Interesting location. Going to fly straight to the middle. Does she have a friend? It looks like... okay, looks like Tychus joined in. She's still sitting on her nuke. Falstad lost his, or still has his. Dahaka still has his, so they just bailed. They bailed, they didn't get their nukes off, ran for it. When Leyline Seal popped out, Medivh. So just a little bit of merc business here. ETC, maybe poking around, see if anyone's hiding out up here. This is one of those scary situations that happens to me a lot as tank. Suddenly a Dahaka. So why was ETC so obsessed with this area? I'm going to rewind a little bit here and find out. Red team has launched a nuke. I guess Dahaka just came in under him, actually. Interesting. He's going to go down. They should be able to get him through this. No, here comes Medivh. Going to come and give him a nice little portal out of there. Well, that's good. So as I was saying there, one of the big problems I have as tank against globals is getting stuck against them. I'm not going to abandon this top lane, but at the same time, no one's coming to take it from me. My whole team's in another fight. I finally get control of the point. They just hearth on back and then teleport to where the fight's actually going on. Now I'm stuck being the awful tank yards and years away. Oh, finally looked like that nuke was going to come out, but nice disengage with the Kerrigan there. And that's an interesting note, too. How much was this focused on? We got Kerrigan's Blades, two different abilities. One with the Spines from the Ground and the Primal Grasp. Another with the Sweeping something or others. What's she got? She's got Impaling Blades and Primal Grasp. Both interrupt a nuke. You've got a Grenade on Medic. You got ETC's Power Slide. And the Leyline Seal, which is easier to coordinate, of course, in a organized play environment. And Tychus has his grenade. I wonder if this was intentional. This is like you kind of do an ETC sort of thing. Do we have enough ways to interrupt an enemy nuke? I mean, Hammer's got her own. Roots aren't going to do anything to it. You got the Winds. But how much was Leyline Seal and Winds picked up in this situation to be a counter to those sort of things? Maybe Blessed Shield, the same reason. Was Blessed Shield picked up for those same reasons? Who knows? But could be something worth considering. You know, we're all very attentive to how many ETC interrupts we have. How much are we paying attention to how much nuke interrupt do we have? Nice job on the Iron Skin there by Johanna. So they're going to go ahead and push in this middle again. ETC once again roaming about. But he does have stage dive, so I guess he can kind of be anywhere he wants, sort of scouting it out, seeing what's available on the map. Gonna get pushed out here by the full team of five. ETC goes to soak the top. How much is that garnishing him? Not a lot. Not very high, but he had to get to 10 first. Well, I guess this is a community tournament, but it's pretty high level, the Zodiac Cup. And interesting to see a Silence player there on the Dahaka. Nasty's now soaking the bottom. Can't take in. Falstad has not been able to use their bribe too much to get around the map at the moment. Let's see, what are they sitting on in terms of stacks? Not a ton. So I guess it's getting used on the back camps. Nuke still sitting on Johanna there. Leyline Seal going out for the engage. Kerrigan's gonna be the tank here. Tank does actually push out. Wow. Nice move on the Malfurion. They're gonna leave him to die. That always feels bad. He has a decent little go, but before he leaves. There's Falstad. Helping take camp with Dahaka. Kinda like this buddy system that they've been up to this whole game. Though I guess our buddy system on the side of 2Bs has been a bit more eloquent? Busy? They've been staying as 3s. They interrupt it yet again. Just loving the protection they're doing on this middle here. Unable to stop Dahaka. Oh, even the medevac comes up. Medevac, huh? You know, let's see. We've already got some weird issues on this replay as it is an old version. But let's see if we can actually see the range on medevac. Looks like it's not going to show. Do you guys know in the chat if medevac has a distance? Because honestly, I see it taken so rarely that I honestly don't know anymore if it has a distance like Falstad's fly or if you actually got to walk a little bit. Ooh, nice little jumps here. That was an odd little graphical thing, but looks like she cast in the right direction. That was an awesome set of ravages that carried her across the map. It does have limited range, okay. So they did maybe have to walk a little bit in order to get in range to put that in there. We got Tychus taking the nuke in the back. Nice little interrupts from Medivh. Falstad flies down to the bottom. So now we're getting into the mid game and everyone's sort of changing things up. No one's really concerned about laning as much. Plus we got some forts gone that are losing some of the safety there. Kerrigan is still going on Johanna down here. Looks like they're gonna abandon this back one finally and see if they can't push out the middle here. Falstad still sitting on that same nuke, it looks like. Looks like our tracker is... Well, nope. It's wrong. We have 3-3, looks like. 3 nukes across each team. Nope, we got a fourth. A fourth for our team B-Genius in the blue. Bad Benny up here. Because he's got stage dive on cooldown. Medivac is on cooldown. Everyone's stuff is on cooldown. Well, except for Hammers, but that's an Napalm Strike. She's putting that out every couple seconds. They're doing a boss again. ETC's gonna find it. And he's just gonna walk on in. Not even a little sneaky move. Just walks right on in and let his presence be known. I guess that is the best way to interrupt it. Here comes the Medivac. And it's got Kerrigan in tow. But Medivh's lagging behind a bit. They're gonna actually isolate Johanna over this path. And the nuke is going to come down for the side of bees. They're going to keep chasing back Johanna. Well, I mean, that'd be Tychus' job, right? Sadly, he can't actually get in range to finish off the kill. What's this even? He ended up going combat tactician. Basic attacks reduce the cooldown of run and gun. Interesting. Never really see that in your solo play. Never see it in my play. Stage dive comes on in. Now, stage dive does have a slow on it. 50% slow for 3 seconds. So sadly, he was off target there. Looks like they took the top boss, forced him out, so the enemy team went to go to the bottom boss now, and they're gonna get it stolen as well. Okay. So maybe despite our global heroes that did have a really nice presence in this game, many of these games do come down to bosses. I'm a bit disappointed because I've seen these sort of wins before in my own game. Just gonna be more boss wins, perhaps. Though, let's check in on this. We got Dahaka and Malfurion defending in the top. They're actually putting out some pretty decent damage. In the bottom here, well, we got 3 nukes coming in alone. One for the front wall, that one just going straight in the middle. We are not after a 14-minute mark anymore. This is after the patch, so they gotta wait till 18 minutes for those nukes to be empowered. Boss is gonna finish it up, though, so they're holding on to the other nukes. And Falstad zones to destroy the boss. Got it. So we got two dropped on the side of B-Genius to counter the boss. Here comes one more nuke with the port or keep just barely inside. Disengage with the wind to stop that final nuke. So while I might be a bit disappointed that this may be a win based on XP from bosses, we can't ignore how awesome each team is doing, how good of a job they're doing interrupting the nukes. That's really important. Both teams are really focused on the nuke game. And we're down to one each. Dehaka and Kerrigan both holding one. So Kerrigan, unable to pick up a nuke, goes into the back and takes a camp. Medivh's gonna do a little bit of annoying bird scouting here. Poop on their tank and whatnot. Sit on their statues. ETC's gonna fire up a camp by himself, but you know, he won't lose too much health doing that. He's got guitar solo, face melt. Nothing's gonna really help him out here. I guess Echo Pedal might do some help for him. Here comes Tychus to help him clean that up. Dehaka doing a nice little dance there, finishing up the camp. Medivh still just sitting on top of the core group here, following them all around. Speaking of which, what is Medivh's speed as we know it now? 20%. 20%. And our normal mounts are down to 30% now. Interesting. Well, he'd be able to keep up with Falstad. Falstad do a bit of bonus movement speed, so he went up to 25%, so he'll just lag behind him a little bit. They're all just camping in the middle. And ETC just waiting on those stage dives. Dehaka's gonna poke it out a little bit, clean up the lane. Falstad is getting entirely locked in the base by Medivh, and it looks like they just don't know where the enemy team is, and of course without a keep down here, there could be a gank coming in. There's also, you know, one lane minion, or one mercenary minion left, but two catapults, two cyclones coming down that lane. ETC's back in his favorite spot in the world, waiting for a stage dive, so they're just keeping it patient, and trying to soak what they can, but as all the forts and all go down, not a lot of good places to hang out and get XP. We got an open camp here. Looks like they're just noticing it now, but it is rather apparent on the map. Even by their movements there, you can see where they're going to be off to. So everyone's just going to back up and play it safe. There's no bosses yet. A minute till that top guy. Looks like Falstad finally stopped being harassed by the bird. Raven is now going down the middle to chase out Malfurion. So it looks like bosses got taken, and it's just a bit of a stalemate now. We do have 3-1 at the bottom here. Looks like it's actually backwards. Is that what's going on there? Weird. Alert. So we got some more nukes now. These will be the empowered nukes, as they become those 18-minute nukes to finish the game out in a good amount of time. Bird's making their way. Looks like ETC is just going to ignore the top, even though he has stage dive. He wants to be in range of this. Why? He's still going to stage dive in. Stage dive must not be global as well. So, chat, you knew this as well last time. Is stage dive global? Does it have a range that we're missing out on? Sadly, we're not able to see that here. Maybe he did have to walk a little bit. And that would certainly inform the way I'm going to play against stage dive ETC. It always feels like he's just infinite. He just sort of jumps at you from anywhere. Well, now we're sitting on certainly wrong numbers. We got 4. Stage dive does have a range as well. Okay, so he couldn't stay in the top and get to that middle part, too. Still one hero. They can't pick it up. They actually can't pick it up. Tychus can't pick it up. I guess Medivh has to come get it. Well, that's one way to win your game. I'm gonna go back on the boss here. Boss available in the top at the moment. Malfurion now sitting on the nuke. And they're gonna have to mobilize and take their own boss pretty quick. The medevac is ready, the stage dive is ready. They saw two of them in the top recently. It looks like they're just gonna, nice little unison there. They're all gonna hearth on back. Here comes the boss. It is coming down a non-defended lane. There's still the well sitting here. Nadeve's gonna do his little bit of poking out. Gonna come see what he can see. Of course, with the medevac and the stage dive, they could do something a little more interesting and make a big old fancy engage. Cyclone's behind this too. Nice little empowered Mighty Gust. Actually, that might be all they need. The medevac used in sort of a old-style Odin way to just get her on out. Okay, hang on. So, first of all, we do have a bit of an oddity here with the replay. It is locking camera on a clicked unit. So we need to find ourselves, first of all, a unit that's not going to die over the course of this battle. So it stops trying to take control of my camera. But now, let's see what the heck happened there, because that actually didn't look too bad for B geniuses, and 2Bs is engaged, looked a little sloppy. So here they come. They're coming in, they're sitting on all these nukes. Every single one of them. So Falstad's gonna make some, okay, so Dahaka makes the hard engage, and then Johanna goes in with the boss in range. This poop here is gonna do damage to the enemy team if they walk through it. Falstad heads in. Good looking stun coming out of Kerrigan here. ETC's up around the top. And our Medivh is flying on top of everybody, still in the air there. Stun hits no one in particular. Kerrigan makes a hard engage into the Falstad. And she gets blown away by his level 20 version of it. That pushes him back. Medivh is in the background, though. Ends up getting the kill. Kerrigan does a very quick re-engage. Maelstrom. ETC stage dives over, not particularly hitting anybody important, but able to get into the back line, isolating the two tanks out, and laser cleans up. Everyone has to run out a little bit, and their medevac was used in that Odin sort of style of yore. Do we have a thing like that? I guess you could say it would be Primal Split would be the closest comparison now. Basically, she popped inside. Wow, that's a lot of nukes. She popped inside the medevac for half a second just so that she could ride it out. And if it died, then she'd pop out with some health anyway. Actually, did she end up doing? No, it's still Carduceus Reactor, but could have gone medbay, which would have healed people inside and in the area around her. So, Tychus leads in damage, not surprising there. Medivh, though, very high. Let's see if all his laning paid off. Not a ton of damage for him. I guess he got locked in the top versus the Dahaka and the Falstad there for a bit. Let's see the XP. Falstad did end up coming out top, and in the very end, ETC takes everything else. Tychus, Dahaka a lot lower than you'd want him going primal aggression, but he was kind of pulled around. How many deaths on Dahaka? Just one, really low kill game. All right, let's see what the deaths were. 4 on Malfurion, good ganks. 2 on Johanna, 2 on Falstad, 2 on Hammer, and only 1 on Dahaka. So he's able to wiggle out of most situations. But the damage of Malfurion was right next to the damage of Falstad and just below the damage of Dahaka. So you got Morales all the way down here, but everyone else more than makes up for it all the way at the top. That's why I've been so digging on Tychus lately, is because you guarantee your team has enough damage while still having enough survivability, unlike Kael'thas, which will bring your team enough damage, but not enough survivability to maybe finish it out. And ETC couldn't grab a nuke because he was already holding a nuke there? Jeez, so they had to leave it, and they were just sitting on the base. Even in the end here, we have this one down in the bottom that's still sitting there, doing a lot of nothing. So, was that better nuke management on the part of 2Bs? Maybe. What actually happened there? And what did you guys think over the course of that? So our second game today is still Warhead Junction. We're still trying to figure it out a bit. But here's another example. We got Astral Authority in the blue here, with many names you may recognize, and Denial Esports in the red here, with other names you may recognize from the NA scene. This is from the North American Nexus Games, the playoff grand finals, and let's go ahead and spoil this yet again, because we're watching for certain things here. Our blue team here is going to win. Our blue team here will be victorious in the end, and that's extra super special interesting, because of course they're up against a professional Lost Vikings. Now, I'm not very familiar with Glaurung's Lost Vikings. It's not something that sort of goes, oh man, Glaurung, he's that Lost Vikings player, right? In your head. But, I mean, King Caffeine, K1 Pro, iDream, like these are all big names, very skilled players. And you fight Lost Vikings a lot. And that's one of the few strategies I actually understand on this map. Take Lost Vikings, make everyone else build a gank comp, and then you just soak it out and win the game by the sheer size of everything. But on the other side, we do have a Zeratul. We have a Falstad. We've got opportunities to gank the Lost Vikings. And it's a lot like I was saying on Into the Nexus this week. If you're going to go against Lost Vikings, you need to make sure every single one of your assassins can kill a Lost Vikings player. Not just maim, not just show off and scare them up. Just, you have to be able to kill them. So that's what this Zeratul is about. That's what this Falstad, even the Vala, is going to be able to do. The Johanna, the Malfurion. The Malfurion was a later pick, actually, in this draft. But still, just a solid healer behind the Johanna, so nothing fancy there. As far as bans here, one of the first bans was ETC and the Muradin, along with the Chen and a Brightwing. So they did get rid of a global healer for Denial Esports. So Astral Authority did have a sense of blocking that out, but otherwise, in the late draft, once the Lost Vikings was perhaps seen or hinted at, we got the Zeratul and we got the Falstad. And Zeratul is going to be a great counter to the Lost Vikings, able to sneak up on them repeatedly. Initialization in progress. Here come our players out on the map. This, of course, will be the side of Denial Esports here. And then in our blue, we have our eventual heroes of the match, which is going to be Astral Authority. And I don't know about you, but I'm having a really hard time keeping track of all these names recently. All these team name changes.
10 seconds.
It looks like we are immediately gonna run into that exact same camera bug, so pardon me for any sort of weird motions. We're just gonna be a little locked on to oddities. Let's go ahead and actually, we'll do it in the background here. Let's go ahead and lock it on to this here fort. And maybe we can move freely from that point on. Lost Vikings is completely split. Otherwise, they are going to soak. It is going to be Baylog in the top, the splash damage one. You got Olaf, your tankiest, in the middle, actually, which would be your most ganked lane. And then down in the bottom is your Eric, who can do a little bit of pinging. Let's just see at the start here. It is going to be Viking bribery, maximum charge, even in death. This is after the patch once again, so these will be 18-minute nukes. And all that sort of business. It also means that Zarya has received her nerfs and whatnot. Tychus this time is going with that press the advantage for the bonus attack range. Otherwise, we got Zeratul with a little bit of regeneration master. Vala could be doing a multi-shot build. That seems to be the first pickup for it. And then a block for JoJo. And here comes Zeratul. He's just going to go visit. This is making me feel so much better right now. I, too, often leave my Olaf to take multiple attacks before I realize what's going on. So they're just going to pressure the bottom here. And I think this is absolutely the right move. They've got the Lost Vikings. They don't have a gank comp, which is something we talked about a lot with the Lost Vikings. You're able to soak all the lanes, and then you build together a comp that can kill anything really quickly. But they went double tank. And you do need a double tank with Zarya. She has plenty of damage, but you need someone to sort of battery off of at times. But also, you just can't do it all yourself. We have Even in Death, which is going to up his damage. So K1 Pro here on Tyrael is going to look to die before anyone else on the team and explode. And then hopefully the Uther-Tychus combo can kind of clean things up. But Uther will be for a stun. That's your engage. That's part of your gank. And then Tychus is able to walk along with people while dishing out a high amount of damage during the stun time. So it's not a bad plan, but it's still missing something that would make this easier, like the Vala the enemy team grabbed for one. But, I mean, even Butcher, Thrall, Muradin, which was banned out early as well. So in that way, maybe Astral Authority did a really good job banning out characters who would help with this gank comp. Maybe they saw it coming down the line. Maybe they've heard something about the Lost Vikings out of Glaurung here. Zeratul's doing non-Zeratul business at the moment. That'll be because of Regeneration Master. He's just looking for orbs. First Warhead deployment as we open up to that 2-minute mark. Looks like they're gonna continue to pressure the bottom here, which is gonna leave three of Astral Authority down there. We'll have to see what Denial decides to do with their rotation. Caterpillar's poking out the top. Not much that Glaurung can do about that here. He's gonna run into Lost Viking. It should be close enough to the wall that he won't die. But one more attack? I mean, maybe Zeratul will go in for it. What's going down here in the middle? Uther and Tyrael are trying to poke it out. King Caffeine is taking care of some minions at the moment. Nice little shot over the wall using that range. This whole time, Eric's down in the bottom soaking and actually attacking. Glaurung looks like he's locked out, but here comes Tyrael. So Fury is not able to grab it. Now Furion's trying to move in. But Olaf's right there. Looks like they actually did gain quite a bit of control. Vala has taken herself back to the bottom. They're just going to soak this out. And that's a good note right there. That Vala decided that this madness was maybe too much for her. And that they'd rather just soak it out. Caterpillar? I think he got killed by Tychus there, but the nuke was awful close. That nuke was just dropped in the middle of the lane there to take out the wall. Who's got our other nuke here? Malfurion. What's he going to do with it? He's actually going to push up to the wall because the wall has no ammo. So he's making a decision here. He's going to go ahead and nuke that fort for what it's worth. There shouldn't be any mules on the enemy team. And I believe, am I thinking of the beta even? I mean, how far back can my mind go here? I don't think Uther even has a chance to get Mule and may never have. Nope. So no mules. I find mules quite helpful on this map, but I've also been digging Abathur. Not in a pure league kind of setting. Just Abathur's fun to play in my random quick matches in the late night. So Vala's still soaking out in the bottom. Johanna's now taking the top, which is a safe place for her to be. She's not going to get ganked or anything like that. Some more auto attacks. Good. Making me feel better about my Lost Vikings yet again. Here comes Falstad. He might be in a little bit of trouble, but actually the damage with Uther, it should be a little low, though, unless Uther can actually get in range for a stun. He's not going to be able to. Zeratul, stealing the camp. What's this here? Vorpal Blade, sure. Fantastic talent for those who can use it. Tychus locking on for a moment there. They're actually going to burn this down, but here comes Zeratul. Vala's still in the bottom. Malfurion's been stuck solo laning for quite a while now. They are going to push him back, but no reason they can't just re-engage with everyone battered up here. Caterpillar's going to have to fly on back in. All right, Malfurion's on the move. Nope, never mind. He's turning back around. Vala continues to push the bottom. Getting herself a tower there. Now, sounds like we lost a Lost Vikings in the top. Not a huge deal, since the rest of the team's already up there and the other two lanes are still soaking. Interesting with the damage of Vala deciding to get Olaf down into the middle. Losing an Eric to Zeratul. So it seems like Glaurung may be a little overtaxed on the Lost Vikings and losing track of himself. Here comes Falstad, just sort of hanging around. I guess there is a lot of missing on the map if we go to his view. Fury take, well, gonna take some stuns, gonna take some damage, nothing wrong there. Now Fury's in range. The fact that does put the stun on cooldown. Here's our next one, so still at about that 6-minute mark. And map timers are all well and good. But what does it actually feel like? Well, it feels like about 3 minutes. Sneaky little Glaurung. Hiding over there. Lost Vikings are going to go for one in the back, maybe while distracting the front. But, well, there goes Eric. one in the bottom here. Looks like they're going to give it up. Lost Vikings is going to take instead of Uther. Uther needs to report to the... well, to the summer. Nothing else is really going on. Oh, nice caterpillar. One more pickup. He's actually going to get this one as well. So we are now going to sit on...
Blue team has launched
a new... there it goes. It's already out. So it seems like Astral Authority is a little more eager to use their bombs. In fact, Vala's going to take a couple shots here just to get it off her person that much quicker. Could have waited, could have taken the tower, but would much rather just get it off already. Looks like we did have a bomb in the bottom there. They're going to let that go. Zeratul's going to report, but there's nothing he can do about it.
Red team has destroyed a fort.
And these teams are just sort of dodging each other right now. We're not seeing the same level of interruption. Nor do I think these teams really thought too much about interruption, but maybe that'll come together later. Zeratul is hanging out around here. King Caffeine is going to get on the pad like a good tank. K1 Pro is going to touch the pad like a good tank. But you can see Zeratul waiting here, seeing if he can sneak it in. Here comes Falstad, actually. Right behind the wall. He's got a win, too. Ooh, this could be interesting. He needs to not be seen, though. There's actually Olaf scouting him out. This could be really cool. Oh. Cleanse. A fantastic, fantastic cleanse. It looked like a spell shield. So both teams have to deal with the boss. I don't know which one I'd rather have. I guess I'd rather defend my bottom lane. But it is a ways away. So they're just going to have to back on out. No nukes on the field at the moment. Good. Good choice. This does leave Falstad down here, though. He's going to be at that for quite a while. Though luckily he won't be hurting himself too much, so he ends up doing static shield and boomerang later. Give himself a little shield right now to continue to intercept that. Looks like Vala's going to report now. So top did lose quite a bit, actually. One nuke's going to clean that up. And Caterpillar's able to deal with this push in the bottom rather swiftly. So Zeratul's still scouting out. We're seeing a little bit of Vikings grouping, but now they're going to go and split off too. He went play it again. Which, if it's anything like my play it again, it'll go horribly underused. And that's probably for the best. And in the late game, the Lost Vikings are going to have a lot more power. So if you're not familiar with Zeratul there, what he did was... ooh, one moment on that. Cool little location on the zone there. Expulsion zone. Flying in, follow. It's a good little stun off, but a laser comes down. Looks like that only affects heroes, actually. Interesting to note. No summons allowed in the sanctification. Cool little dance there. Nobody dying. At any rate, Zeratul engaged, landed his spike, but then used his Vorpal Blade to catch up to the target that he lost auto-attacked, and that's how he was able to close the distance on a speedy little Viking. Caterpillar making a run for it, but it looks like he'll be okay. Uther won't be able to get in range here. Though maybe he's taking the damage, which is turning off his Tailwind, and yeah, he was able to get in range. Here comes Zeratul. It's going to be too late. Oh! Trying to squeeze against the wall, maybe do a little barrel roll over it as you come off cooldown. That's going to be a nuke off the Vikings. A secret nuke that didn't show on our display, perhaps. Expulsion zone just used very quickly to get things out of the way, and they're just going to run away, unable to complete it. Lawn misses. Two Vikings now having to defend the top. Well, that should be fine. Looks like Spalm is moving in on Olaf, and, well, we'll get this kill. He's still got his Vorpal Blade to teleport over to that. So with no fort in the top, yeah, now the Lost Vikings are having to group up a little bit. This is getting kind of messy for them. Ooh. They're going to decide to take a camp right as they're being chased. Great shot there by King Caffeine. Hit him as he moves through the air. Nice little bit of splash damage there on Balog. Boy, they're really drawn to these camps. the only thing on the map. It's pretty obvious there's gonna be some business that goes down here. Looks like Caterpillar is once again trying to set up for a sweet win. My guess would be Uther's gonna hover around. Oh! Wait. Nope, there's the minion's inside. It's still got a little bit of health. It's still inside. Oh! So the wind grabbed the mercenary there. And that ended up in the void prison as well. Aw, oh, cute move all the same. Looks like our Zeratul will explode in that case. Just barely enough room. It would have been unstoppable with JoJo, but still. Barely enough room for her to sneak by. Falstad heads down to the bottom. If he can get a Lost Vikings, that'd be fine. That'd be a good pickup. We're still not seeing any uses of Plaid again yet. He hasn't lost any Vikings, but I'm always interested to see how he's going to move them around the field. Actually, let's investigate the Vikings real quick and see what bribery is looking like at the moment. Two stacks. There's nothing to take on the map. I wonder if it's even worth it on this map, as you may get stuck with all the camps taken and no real reason to actually use the Viking briberies. It's a big map and there's such long cooldowns between the nukes that if everything gets decided pretty quickly, they may not actually get that much value because everyone's failed before. Though being in range here, these little sparkles are from Mercenary Lord. He's enhancing his nearby mercenaries by 50%. And able to take a little less damage from them so he can solo them himself. Here's Tychus doing a camp now. A camp with that Vikings has two bribery for, so surely not getting too much value at the moment, but the enemy team's so squirrely. Astral Authority's really pulling them around. Ooh, good heal onto Eric there. Completely dissuades him. Not a lot of health on him, of course, but he's gonna get pushed out. Eric's gonna chase him, looking for a spin to win to reactivate him, but looks like he loses control as Falstad actually went down in the bottom. Now he's gonna fly back into the middle, win them into a corner there. We still have a number of ults to go. There goes the laser. It's actually out of range. The range goes to about here. So it's actually not gonna get a lot done. Roots land true. Sanctification doesn't have anyone inside. Void Prison comes out. And lots of laser damage into Johanna there, but she don't care. She's got Iron Skin ready. Even in death is going to allow the ghost to teleport a little bit. Laser goes down, Caterpillar pushes them out. And yeah, how much value is this going to get? And is it equal to the value of all these nukes? I guess not. It does seem like a bit of a weak Lost Vikings team. Perhaps in terms of damage. And in fact, let's look at that damage right now. Valen, Zeratul leading the way by quite a bit. Zarya actually at the top. Tychus well below that, and then Tyrael down there. So Tychus, such a squirrely team, doesn't have anyone but Johanna really to wail on. And his drill was out of range. Let's see what he went. Bigger they are. Still a bigger they are. Probably the right choice here with only a Johanna to wail on. Everything else is pretty darn standard. But not able to bring the big damage numbers. And here yet again, iDream is stuck taking a camp. Where's our Lost Vikings at the moment? We got, oh! All three are dead. Well, that makes sense then. You can't use Play It Again if you're all dead. Looks like we did use Play It Again. But of course, now they're all dead. Once again, locking on that camera to the core there. I'm not sure why that helps. Boss pushing out the bottom. They're gonna go steal yet another boss in the top. They're gonna let this fort fall instead of maybe dealing with a second boss that is going to come down a lane where there's no defenses. So let's see how they get in position here. We got four in the top. Falstad's actually the one poking it out, not Zeratul at the moment. He's still got the fly, he's got the barrel roll, everything else. He's just trying to be a little squirrely around here. I guess when it comes to locking down things, when you're trying to get a boss, a wind would be a bit more powerful than a void prison, but the boss is already taken. Now we have two Vikings stuck in the bottom, walking through the poop, actually, taking all that damage. They're gonna push him back here. Boss in the background yet again. We got, what, how many nukes we got? We got two? Three nukes for the blues. Almost losing another Lost Viking. These guys aren't gonna be able to do enough damage. Actually, they did, thanks to the catapult. They were finally able to take out that boss. And here comes the next one. And they're still early. They're 3 minutes early for empowered nukes. But, oh, wow, nice sanctification. They're actually going to be unmoved. But the Void Prison comes right on out. Actually, great bit of damage. Great coordination. Two charges on the Reign of Vengeance actually cleans up. K1 Pro goes down. Caterpillar should survive this. He's got a two-level lead. And while King Caffeine is continuing to put out a ton of damage, I think the boss is locked on at this point, and it's time to drop some nukes. Here comes Caterpillar. He'll get his off. And looks like Fury's going to be fine, and that'll be the end of the game. So, we've learned some things today. We learned that you do a boss and you win with a boss, and that allows you to drop the nukes. So bosses are extremely important. Being able to get both bosses is awesome. And if one team gets both bosses, it usually means they're going to win. And I think that's more powerful, actually, than what Cursed Hollow has to say about the bosses. Because there, if you take both bosses, yeah, it feels real good. But the way the tributes work, with a single location, there's always the chance for a team fight. However, if you take both bosses, it means you have map control, which means you probably get the warheads in the first place. What did you guys think? Everyone out there. I mean, what did you all think of that? I think Glau only went Lost Vikings because it's a show match. His micro doesn't seem to be on a level he's comfortable with. Sure. Well, and actually, the reason we did Zodiac Cup today and the Nexus Game show match is because nobody's picking Lost Vikings, or no one's picking Warhead Junction in serious environments right now, actually. So we had to go in kind of a weird place for it. Greer says, I think it comes down to team fights. So unless you can get an early XP lead, then the team fight comp is what counts. I think Sub-Moro is going to be very powerful here. You bring a lot of raw damage, but if you can get your stacks up on your windwalking talent, I think he'll be a very good ganker here and could pair extremely well with the Lost Vikings. Hey, Bubbly Bear, good to see you, man. Yeah, I mean, sure, maybe the Lost Vikings wasn't up to par with what was needed. I think that was very encouraging because it felt like my own level of Lost Vikings. But at the same time, they just didn't draft a very powerful comp for it either. Oh, I've never done anything like this before, but we're streaming at an odd time today, so I figured, why not give me the perfect global team with Sub-Moro versus five real people, and let's see if they're able to pull it off. Let's see how powerful globals are. Of course, they got themselves a Falstaff of their own, a Sub-Moro of their own, but Sylvanas, Li Ming, Muradin, all good choices. But let's see how they fare against my global team. Of course, I can't control whether ETC here picks Stage Dive. If he does Mosh, that's kind of cute too. We'll see what happens. And I'll be able to ping my teammates a little bit, so I may be able to eke out a little more than they're capable of, right? Of course, I have tried just having five computers versus five computers. Those games don't go very quick. Nor does Blizzard seem to hide secret strategy information inside of those. So, it's a big map, and my big curious first thought is Way of the Wind. Attacking a hero from Windwalk increases the movement speed bonus of Windwalk by 1.25 up to 25%. After hitting 20 heroes, the duration before Windwalk can be broken by damage is increased by 2.5. So, let's go hunting. Looks like I'll have a Robo Dahaka with me. Let's hit some heroes. So this will be up by 25%, currently 30%. That'll be pretty darn fast. And let's see how the enemy team decides to split here. Brightwing giving away my location. Dahaka having a bit of a hard time. Gosh, he does fantastic damage, doesn't he? Let's give this a minute here. Activate the crit before we go in for the stealth. ETC's soaking the top. Looks like we have nobody in the bottom at the moment. Dahaka might be able to go cover that. Alright, I want to hit heroes, don't I? Illusions count as heroes, it seems. My Falstad's going back. Dahaka is dancing around the top. Oh, I gotta get hero hits it. Oh, that broke me. Good stun. Let's go visit Falstad in the bottom. How many hits am I up to? Okay, 2.5, so still not faster than mounting speed. I've already got a crit ready. So I can get a second one out here. Ooh, nice little flip animation there. Sadly, we didn't actually pop it, but... Stealthing on in. Dahaka's doing a good delay tactic. Falstad should be dancing around this area. Here we go. Oh, I can break the lightning anyway. That's on me. Still fighting it out on top. Looks like my computers are getting zoned. Four hits in, 5% movement speed. So all I gotta do is get... No, I should be good. I never have to mount again now. 30%. All right, no more mounting.
Enemy new. Launch.
Got the crit. Turned down. Actually, I do have a lack of interrupts, it would seem. Or the actual nukes. 60% less damage while windwalking. Spell shield. Couple of bows. Basic attacks. Some more. What's this? While advanced strike is active, so while I'm hitting heroes, I get some resilience. Is it going to be a storm? Sure. Ribe. Not a ton of spell damage, but we do have Lily winds. Let's do Mirage. Oh, I intercepted. I caught for the Falstad. Only I had lifesteal. Samuro coming in. My computers love the top. I think we may have to force ourselves into the bottom a little bit to keep the XP going strong. But we can dance around a little bit. Soak XP. Nice and close. Dodge things. Go clean up that bottom. Looks like we may have a Dahaka going down. ETC is gonna go solo the middle a little bit. Oh, I can't select him, right? Not yet. I doubt I'll be doing that talent. Let's go ahead and get the crit ready. Movement speed is going to help me actually catch up to Falstad here.
Strike unseen.
Oh, it broke me. It stayed locked, didn't it? Okay, so I need to split to break that. Those should scare him off, though. The raw damage might be enough. Should have popped my crit before doing that. Dahaka got it. There he is. More progress. Falstad, focus!
Lost.
I need to choose some talents. Oh, ouch. One thing I've learned recently on Assassin is you should always stick around, even though you really, really, really want to leave. Cool, we're done. Yeah, let's do that. Actually, we do have them pushing the top, don't we? Alright, let's get this. Two charges is easy for each image you have. We did put a little bit of power. I just want my auto attacks to steal some health. I know that'd be overpowered, but it's all I want in the world. Well, we did do well on nukes there. Let's see if that can... That's enough to get us back in the game. Catching up on Lili anyway. Actually got out of hit. Let's see if we can walk these computers into the top. I'm doing 8 of 20? 10% more? That's okay. All the damage is going into the tank right now. Let's change that up. Use my 20% movement speed. After hitting hero, that is. Right wing does go down. Oh, there go the nukes. There go my computer nukes. So we gotta get the quest complete before I get the unbroken time. Don't need to mount no more, though.
An allied fort has fallen.
It's not bad if you do the dance. Almost made it to 10. Falstead, live! My stealth, no! I don't know if this experiment is working. We're getting wrecked. 5 levels up. Go, computers! Use your nukes. No, they no longer have any. No, Falstead's got a nuke. Use your nukes defensively. ETC goes down. Daka is still alive. Gets a nice little stun off. Right wing is, well, she got a nuke in the top. That's good. Woo, double kill.
Triple kill.
Is that real? I don't need to mount up. I've got too many hits now. But I guess I am on cooldown. Let's see how I do stealing a camp. I guess I should have split and then activated the critical strike. The illusions are actually lasting a lot longer than I thought they would. Good experiment. Hey, Lili died to something. Oh, Looks like I just had a Falstad fly by. Yep, they're just stealing the camp there. We got nukes, dudes, let's use them! Oh no! Oh, that'll be it. I think that'll be the end of the game with that much stuff. Oh, and they picked up the nukes too. Ah well, nice little defense. What would I have gone here? Basic attacks against heroes reduce cooldown of mirror image. Nah. Image of your location? Maybe. I think the teleport the short distance though is where it would have been. Oh, actually, ETC is doing pretty well here. He's getting kind of deep. He's actually gonna push them off a little bit. Live, Dahaka! Stand still! Still haven't completed the quest. I need 3 more hits. Oh, oh. Revealed. Too early. Go, computers. Nice shot, computer. Hey, that's a nuke for us. Yeah, nice engaging, ETC. Oh, snap. ETC Computer Pro. I think it's a patience thing. Just being too impatient on the windwalks. That teleport was pretty cool, though. Actually ended up going out in front there. Let's deal with this bottom. Gosh, I would like splash damage. What's the cooldown on this guy? 110? It's a bit too long for me to want to use it here, but you know what? Let's go ahead and do that. That's fake, yes? Why would it be running? That doesn't seem right. I guess I did activate mine later than him. So, if that's the case, yeah, he'll be right here. And once again, I activate later than him, so mine should last a little longer. Nice arrow. Yeah! Yeah! That's good. Oh, wait. Oh, okay. Close shot, though. Dahaka. Computer Dahaka. Gets back. We got dead computer Falstad.
Enemy nuke launched. Enemy nuke launched.
Wow.
Enemy.
I mean, my damage just seems high enough that I can just burn a Muradin pretty easy. Anything you can get to stand close to you long enough, you can kill. I can leave those two to mine that lane. Looks like I will just barely be short on time. I can get him. Let's be more careful. Gosh, I'm booking it though.
Work order complete. Warheads.
All right, we got to make sure we catch him out early enough. I wasn't able to kill the Lily. Nice shot though. Go drop your nukes, ETC. get the crit ready. The perfect gank. No Brightwing live.
Terminated.
Go ahead and destroy the dot on myself. Oop. Two seconds.
Killing spree. Ally
key. Oh dear. How long do we have to wait? Oh, well, now I'm on site. Oh, good shot! No! Good shot. It was a good dance, though. That was fun. Computers are still holding out. Now, let's see. Does ETC still have his nuke? He does. Brightwing's got one, too. Maybe if I ping... Go use your nukes. Go use your nukes, computers. You can do it. Yeah, they're closing in! Yeah, he's doing it! Ooh, what coordination. Right on top of each other. Let's do Windwalk cooldown. Over-aggressive. Gosh, we've got nothing, though. Alright, let's see. They've used the nukes. Let's see if we can get them. Defend the core! Nah, they don't care. I can clean it up. Oh! Wow! Good silence, though. That goes right wing, but Falstad, I think, can get the tank. Does that only work on heroes, the bonus? Oh my god, that's a lot of attacks. Attacking a hero from Windwalk. Oh wait, no, I don't want him out. I'm too fast. Too fast for mounting. Alright, Falstad's got it. Right? Let's take it up this direction. But that was a good hit. None of them connected. What's going on in the base here? Catapults. Okay. Oh wait, no, that all needs stopping. That bot needs stopping. Do they have nukes? Are they trying to close in?
Alert. Your core is under attack.
Shields hold. Hold shields. Dahaka goes down and gets the bottom nuke.
Collection complete. I see it coming down.
Alright, big old push. Brightwing's going down. Good and spooked, which is a good thing. Oh, hurt.
Alert. Your core is under attack. Enemy new.
Ah, oh, couldn't stop it. No, no! Ah, that'll be the end. It was a good hold. GG! I enjoyed that. I hope you guys did too.